Hello, and welcome to this week's episode of the Weekly Song Podcast. Just a little forewarning this time. Due to technical difficulties, the audio quality may vary slightly this week. Apologies for that, we've done our best. I hope you still enjoy it, and yeah, on with the show.
Hello, you're listening to the Weekly Song Podcast, and my name is Roger, and with me as always is my co-host, Declan Kitchener. Hello, Declan.
Hello.
And for you, those of you who aren't familiar with the show, this is the show where we write a song each per week, bring them to the podcast and discuss the lyrics and the chords and the inspirations and the influences and everything that goes into writing a song. And we bought two new songs for you this week. And yeah, how's it going, Declan? How are you?
It's going reasonably well, thank you. How is it going for yourself?
It's going good. It's going good. I was late writing this week. That we've been writing for now. So I started on Monday and had a seed and then found myself waiting till about Saturday or Sunday to really finish. Because as you can see in the background on YouTube here, I'm moving house. So it's been...
It is looking a bit barren. The cupboards are bare, so to speak.
I felt like I had to address that for some reason. But anyway, so yeah, how was your writing week this week?
It was relatively straightforward. And in fact, I wrote a day earlier than I'm supposed to. We normally write Monday to Sunday. I always write on the Sunday. And this week I wrote on the Saturday. So, you know, progress.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay, so we're listening to your song first this week. So tell us, what's it called? And then we'll take a listen.
So this song is called Carried Under. And it goes like this.
The perfect day, in every action, every moment just the same, and I can't stand it. Oh no, open ears, an empty headed, every memory crystal clear, only reliving. Darling, please, can you listen to my needs? 'Cause I'm being carried under by my doubts. Think you've got a clue, but the problem's not the same. We don't know what to do. We just have had it. Oh no, oh no. Love is fine, you can never read my mind. And if I ever find you, I won't force you out. But darling, please, won't you listen to my needs? 'Cause I'm being carried under by my doubt. Just to say, shoot the shit, and breaking it down. Oh, just a day, far away from everyone now. But who am I talking to? Who are you talking to? Being drowned by sounds of you give me space to figure this one out.
Okay, so that was Declan's fourth song of the season. That was Carried Under. And I'm a huge fan of this, particularly how it ebbs and flows in tempo. And I don't know, there's just so much going on in the song. It was one of my favorites so far. So how did it start?
It started by watching YouTube, as all good songs do.
Yes.
Roger and I both watch this YouTuber called Mike the Snare. And he has this series called Deep Discog Dive, where he goes into the output of a band. And he's released one very recently on the band Rat Boys, which is quite a good episode. I really enjoyed it.
I haven't seen this yet. I've never even heard of Rat Boys.
I think you might enjoy this episode. I recommend going to watch it. But they're kind of like a American sort of indie, like slightly rough and ready guitar thing, but also with more like considered like lyrical stuff. And it's just that sort of sense of like being four people in a band playing together. It's just like, I'd like to write something that would be fun to do that way. So literally halfway through the episode, put it on pause and just came up with that riff. It's a very simple riff. It's F sharp to B to E with a little do-do-do-do, which is just F sharp, G sharp, B, C sharp, to throw in there for every now and then.
Nice.
And yeah, that's the bulk of it, basically, verse wise. It's literally just designed to be like, can we just thrash this out on two electric guitars, a drum kit, and a bass? Cool. Let's go with that then.
I like that. Just the fact that you've got these simple chords going, but you've got that little lick going. I think just like even a little fill-in lick like that can really push the song in a different direction. Was that like a conscious choice where you thought, I want to spice this up a bit, or is just that how you are as a guitarist?
It just needed a break between doing those, because it's a short, repetitive set of chords. It needs a break every now and then. So after every odd numbered go on it, that helps it break it up a little bit. It also ended up informing like the melody's shape. So when you're singing over it, like it's a bit awkward to sing over that bit, at least for me, because I'm very lazy at creating melodies. So what ended up happening was going like it sort of impacts the sentence structure of it a little bit.
So you're singing around that little guitar fill, is it? Or am I misunderstanding?
You're correct. Yeah, it's keeping out of the way of that a little bit. Just because it'd be weird to sing over it. It's not the world's greatest guitar fill. It's four notes. But like it's nice to sort of keep it sort of a bit separate and a punctuating thing. The chorus is kind of where I abandoned the concept of keeping it simple.
I was going to say, that's where we kind of really take a bit of a left turn in the song.
It's based around C sharp minor, G sharp major 7, E flat diminished, because diminished chords are the best.
Yeah, you've been throwing a lot of diminished chords in the mix, and your choruses particularly this season.
They're my favorite chords. So goes from C sharp minor, G sharp 7, E flat diminished to A major 7, to C, to B over F sharp to E.
Okay.
And then rinse and repeat. And it's one of those things where it's just like, okay, the chorus doesn't resolve. How do you get back into it?
I like that. But what I love about that is, like, because I haven't heard Rat Boy, but from how you're describing him, I imagine four people in a room thrashing out some, you know, straightforward chords, perhaps something that everybody can learn fairly quickly. But then you get to the chorus, and not only does the rhythm change up to this like do 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 type of sound, but you throw in all these different chords which flavor the progression.
So this doesn't end up sounding like Rat Boys at all. Their style is something a bit more specific, a bit slightly softer, slightly more thought out. This was just kind of like born of the thing of like, what would be fun to play in a band? Which is why that chorus is like all those stabs. Like, just like, yeah. Okay, you are paying attention now.
Yeah. Like,
the only other bit to talk about really is that middle section. Because I just thought halfway through, I think I got like a rough melody for the verses and the chorus together. I thought, right, okay, so I'm going to need some sort of break section. I was like, okay, what if I just put in a slow crooner bit?
Yeah, yeah, and it does sound like that. It sounds to me almost like a Bohemian Rhapsody thing where you had one song and then you were like, I don't know what to do with that, and then you wrote another different song and then put it in the middle. But I'm guessing that's not how it was, so how did that happen?
It's just thought it'd be fun to slow down. It's kind of like an inverse When the Sun Goes Down, because that starts off with that really slow bit like, and what a scummy man, and like all of that sort of stuff before it goes into dun 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 bow 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 da da.
Yes.
Like, flip that around so that the rest of it comes first.
I like that, but it's that you pulled off an amazing feat because it doesn't feel out of place. I know it sounds like a different session, but it's like, oh, okay, I'm going along with this. This really works.
Harmonically, it uses a fair few of the same chords. So it starts off on an A major 7, which is in the chorus. It goes to an E flat diminished, which is in the chorus. It goes to a E major 7, which isn't, but E is an important chord in the song.
Yeah.
Going down to a C sharp minor, which again is in the chorus, so it's all harmonically related. And then A minor to B7, A minor over C to B7 again. They're not unknown chords within the structure of the song because you've got that C to B over F sharp bit in there. So it's kind of like, okay, let's take all these quotes, put them here, and rearrange them. And now let's put a guitar solo in there because I can't think of how to get out of it.
I mean, that is it. When in doubt and you want to get, you're like, what do I do here? Guitar solo your way out of any situation.
That's good life advice, that is. In trouble, guitar solo.
that could be a title. But no, I love it. I mean, the fact that when you slowed down and you're like, I'm gonna have this just slow down here for a bit, did that inform where you wanted to take the song in terms of vocal delivery and lyrical content?
Probably not. I just thought that would be a fun thing to put in there. Because obviously the rest of the song is quite fast and hyperactive, so it's nice to have that slowdown section, like a moment of reflection that you could like have loose enough to sort of shift about a bit and change the feel of. What ended up determining what the words were when I was just scatting through the melody, I ended up coming up with the sentence to start the chorus. I think I've got it written down here. I don't mind if you couldn't read my mind, which I thought there's something in that.
Yeah.
It's also wrong because you're rhyming mind with mind, which two different meanings of the same word, but it can work.
I like it. I think that kind of stuff. Rappers do it a lot. I have a book about how to rap and it says rappers do that. That's just a whole chapter. Rappers do that.
Rappers do that. Another possible title. I sort of restructured that, and then that was kind of the first line of the chorus. Love, it's fine. You could never read my mind. It's like, okay, cool. So this song is about two people who can't talk to each other. Okay, that's the rest of the song then.
Yeah. I like that. Like, because once you kind of get a couple of different you, me type of thing, you know how many people are in the song.
Exactly, yeah. And like, because it's quite frenetic, it implies that the situation's been going on a long time, so like you just write down things that sort of play into that, like the whole bit, like open ears and empty headed, and we're just reliving memories, and like you get the idea that someone is frustrated by like being in the same place, which is sort of fun to sort of then play around when you get to the slow bit. Like, so what would help? What would help this person? It's like going the fuck away from everybody.
I've got to say, in the best possible way, that's the most Declan approach to a lyrical change I've ever heard.
And then, like, it's just trying to invert that in the final chorus while keeping, like, the whole meaning of it. So it's like having the message of, like, yes, okay, cool, this stuff happens. We just have to deal with it. Give me some space. But also, the problem is not solved.
Definitely. I think that's a really good thing to highlight as well, is like, if you're not sure where to go with a lyrical direction, just ask a different question. You know, like you said, I forget exactly what you said, but like, what should they do about this? You know, that's a really good, opens up a few lanes for you.
And if you really can't think of anything, add another guitar solo.
That is good life advice. That is good. So I imagine this was one where you wrote, obviously, music first, and then you kind of were scatting that line, so you had a couple of lines to go on. Did the lyrics take many rewrites once you kind of had the music down, or was it, like, pretty much all out in one go?
Pretty much all out in one go. I'm just looking towards my lyric book here, and I only crossed out 3 lines in the whole thing.
Oh.
So quite a speedy process. This one came out really quickly, which is partly because it's incredibly simple for the most part until you start putting thought into it, but also just some songs come quicker than others, and for what it's worth, this scatty little nothing decided that it was going to be like one of the quick ones.
Nice. It's great. It's really good. And I think that idea of having it be a band song is definitely true.
It informs everything to the point where, like, even in the slowdown section, you could imagine like a singer like leaning on the microphone and like trying to cue the band, and then maybe like a 6/8 feel coming in on that bit, like.
Ooh. This is you doing your best Alex Turner, basically.
Now, if only I could do the accent.
Did it earlier.
I said a bit that you... No, sorry.
What a scummy lad. There you go. Terrible.
I apologise to Sheffield.
Sorry, Sheffield. I'm sorry. Oh, that's excellent. Shall we... is there anything else you want to touch on with this one?
I think that's about all I have to say for this one. I would like to play it and maybe do it live one day, but also that middle section is going to be the undoing of it. Like, because you could get people hyped up and then just go, and for about 30 seconds, we're doing nothing for a little bit.
Mm.
Why are you all leaving? Come back, come back, come back!
There's a guitar solo in a second, I promise.
Which I can't play for you, but you'll have to imagine it. And so we move on to the second song of the week. We move on to Roger's song. Roger, what have you got for us?
Okay, so this song is called Head in the Sand. And I'll tell you before we even start, it started in a very inspirational environment. I went to go and see my accountant, and he gave me the idea for the song. He didn't know he did, but he did, though. It's called Head in the Sand.
Best songs start in an accountant's office.
Accountant's office and YouTube. We have the best inspiration this week.
And hopefully all songs end there as well, all good ones.
I'm going to go back and play it for him and see if he can write it off against my expenses. Okay, it goes like this.
Well, the world goes round and round and I just stand hiding like a bird with my head in the sand. Winter's coming on, but I can't quit. I'm losing all my feathers again. Turning around in expectation, getting ideas above my station, pulling me up to push me down again. foiled by every path not taken, ticking them off in my frustration, walking around in circles once again. While the world goes round and round and I just stand, hiding like a bird with my head in the sand. Winter's coming on but I can't quit, I'm losing all my feathers again. Taking my time with new decisions, painting the walls inside my prison. Bunch of contestants are running around on me, waiting around for something better. You always used to say my letters would do better good a little further away from me. Because the world goes round and round and I just stand, hiding like a bird with my head in the sand. Winter's coming on but I can't quit, I'm losing all my feathers again. Wasting all my time, days go speed.
So that was Roger's weekly song, Head in the Sand. And I've got to tell you, my head was not in the sand. My head was between my headphones, as all good heads should be, listening to this song. It's great. Not one of my best transitions, but we're keeping it. So how does your accountant feel about this song? And are they going to sue you for libel?
I mean, they are litigious people, so probably. I don't know how he feels. I probably won't show him. I mean, probably. It depends how friendly. He's new. He's my new accountant, so it depends how close we get, really. Anyway, drifted off into my own thoughts. Yeah. Sorry.
Oh, my accountant. Oh.
Ooh. Nigel.
All of a fluster thinking about him.
I mean, this one started at his office, where, as I said in previous weeks, like, you know when you're kind of keeping your ear out. You know you've got to write a song by Sunday, so you're keeping your ear out, even when you don't really mean to throughout the week, just for any little phrases or anything like that. And I was talking to him about, because I've never had an accountant before, and I had my first meeting with him, and I was talking about this and that, and then he started telling me a story about an old client of his, and he said, I had this dyslexic client once, and really he just kind of like put his head in the sand and he kind of avoided really doing it, and he kind of got behind on things. And I went, oh, really? Okay. And then when I went out, I was like, head in the sand's a good little phrase, you know? So
I sense a song here somewhere.
That's it, but you don't know what it means yet. You don't know what's that about. It sounds good, but what's it about? So
what is it about? Like, where did the process lead you next?
Well, it kind of rattled around in my head for a little while. Meanwhile, I'd come home and that evening I wrote the verse chords for the song. Didn't have anything that it actually meant yet, but I came up with the verse chords, started scatting things over them, and similarly to how you do. And the one line that came to me that kind of stuck out through my scatting over the melodies and the chords was swimming around in expectations. And what does that mean? And how does that tie to head in the sand? And I think the idea of like having your head in the sand and being sort of passive about things, like not really kind of dealing, like that had the way that the actual person in the anecdote was described, not dealing with something until it kind of like all piles up on you, and then it's kind of like more difficult to deal with. So kind of just relating that to various micro situations in my life of like, that could be better if I was more actively engaged with it, or like, that wouldn't be so bad if I worked on it, and all these type of things that we all go through. And so just kind of like went through with the chords, trying to come up with like various different things for that. And I kind of came up with a few different ideas, but really where the song took off is in the chorus. So the chorus has a different feel to the verses, and the chorus is very simple. It's just like the song's in E major, and you're going A major, E major, A major, E major, A, E, B. And then the only really slightly weird bit is you go A, E, G sharp, 7, C sharp minor. I don't know why I have to do the pitch. A, B, E, you know?
Which is kind of similar to how in my song there was those similar chords. They ended up sort of in the same key, where G sharp major is the major third of the scale. So normally that chord is minor, you turn it into a major. Creates this very Beatles-esque kind of sound if you use it in the right way, and then like resolving to that minor six, the C sharp minor in this case, to sort of give it that particular feel. That's a very fun chorus. I love the bass on it on the demo that we just heard.
Thanks. I mean, we were talking during the listening of it, and I think you and I both made our demos like just before the podcast, to be completely frank. And so that bass line was just a last minute, like adds a bit of bounce to it, you know, just something to add to the production a little bit. But yeah, the chorus was so simple that I almost kind of shunned it. You know, do you ever do that where you go, this is so straightforward that it should have more to it? I thought, no, it works, you know, it sounds good, so it's kind of the aim, right?
Which again, we've kind of done the opposite in this week, whereas I've got a very simple verse going into a slightly weirder chorus. You've got like some very nice chord movements in the verse, and then you go into that very basic but very sing-alongable, like that very sort of straightforward chorus.
Yeah, definitely. I think the chorus, I think I lent into that sort of more sing-along chorus because we met with Chris last week, Chris Baker, aka Lunacy, who's been a past guest on the show. And he was saying to us that he was talking to somebody in open mic a while back, and they said something to the effect of, how come you write this style of song? You know, and then he started to think about how the audience would hear it. And I guess I wanted to write a chorus this time around that was more of a sing-along, something that people could kind of grasp easily, that wasn't, you know, you could just kind of get it under your belt pretty quickly, and it's very singable, you know, like you said.
And it's got that sort of like different feel, that bit more momentum to it, so you can have a bit of a boogie and a bit of a dance to it. This is how I dance. I don't frequent the discotheques very often.
Well, YouTube, you're missing out if you're not on YouTube, okay? Because you're seeing some great moves. You're seeing a rugby cut over here.
I've literally got the scissors over there and a piece of rug for later. There are a couple of like cool chord movements in the verses, and there's also like that nice tonal shift in the bridge. So what exactly is going on there?
Well, the first thing I came up with for the song, apart from the title, was this chord, which I'll show you. All it is, for the audio listeners, on YouTube you can see this, by the way, but I'm going 5th fret D string, 5th fret G string, 5th fret B string, 5th fret A, E string, and then an open A in the bass. And it's a very basic chord to play. But, you know, it has a really nice tonality. And I believe it's an A minor 7. I had to look it up, but...
That is correct, yeah. It's a voicing of that with that. Because you've got that very low note, but then the rest of the notes are quite high up, relatively speaking. The nearest note is 10 semitones above the bass note.
Exactly, yeah. So I knew I liked that chord, and I hadn't really played that chord. Not, I played A minor 7 plenty of times, but like playing that particular shape...
Look, I'm playing it now!
But the lovely thing about the guitar is you could play the same chord in a different position, and it inspires a whole slew of other ideas. So I played this, it's a one finger chord, really. And I was thinking, play that, and then I'll play the seventh fret on the E string, just to give a little bit of movement. Da 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 da. And I thought, take that same rhythm and that same feel and move it to a different chord. So I go to an E major triad, and I turn that into an E sus 4, you know, hammer that on and off. Da 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 da. And then initially, I then went to a B and did a similar thing, and then went to an E to resolve. But as the demo progressed and I started writing more, I found myself throwing a D major in there, which is a non-diatonic chord, and going D and doing a bit of sus stuff there, B, E. So automatically you have kind of, you have the A minor 7, which has a certain feel to it, like that adds a bit of something or other to it. And then you have the D in there, which adds, again, a little bit of angular movement to the chord progression. So you've got a few things kind of going on in there, but nothing too crazy.
But it just adds a really nice flavor to that bit, which is kind of cool. Like, again, it's a nice contrast of having like a relatively simple section and then having another section where you go like, and here are my favorite chords. Look at them all. Yeah. That'd be amazing. This song also, in the demo stage, has a guitar solo, which is a bit unusual for yourself. Like, you put guitar solos in your finished songs, but it's rare that they kind of form a part of... core part of the middle of a demo. So what went about inspiring its inclusion here?
Well, I got to the bridge, and then I knew that after the bridge I wanted to have a guitar solo or something. Again, kind of like you said, like, what should happen after the bridge? And I need to get to a chorus at the end because that's the climax of the song, but what should go in the middle? I thought guitar solo will be a good thing to put there. And I found myself just going to the root of the song, E major. And I was just singing, just this melody that fits over just a single held E major chord for like 8 or 16 bars. And I was like, I kind of like the idea of that being played on guitar rather than sung. And I like the idea of a guitar solo being just one chord for a long time. I thought that's kind of interesting. I haven't done that before. And then thought, to really up the ante, kind of like throw it up to the chorus chords. So you're going up to the 4 and back to the 1 and doing the whole chorus and just playing over that. So I think kind of just necessity, really, just like I didn't know what to put there. Guitar solo.
But also it's interesting that it has that origin in that long sort of sustained section, which, yeah, when you think about guitar solos, you don't really think about them like just staying on one chord for a while.
No, exactly. I don't have a real reason for the one chord thing other than that I hadn't done it before and it was kind of exciting to me.
You ran out of your chord allocation. You only had one chord left, so you were going to make the most out of it.
Oh my God. Imagine it was like that. You just kind of like, oh no, I've only got 3 chords left to use. What do I do?
It's kind of like all those rules on classical music where you couldn't like move the notes in a certain way. Otherwise it would sound like the devil's music or things like that. It's just like, man, you're just missing out on so much. You could have your cheeky cross lines where they sort of hit the wrong notes.
Oh,
it could be a little bit of ear candy for you there, but no.
A little bit of devil in your music is good for you, I think.
Exactly. I approve this message.
It's like that old sacred music of those days, like on harpsichord and stuff. They would use, like you say, very specific informed notes. But then the great thing about modern gospel is they'll use all the demon notes and it sounds so much better for it.
Yeah, that's why it sounds so amazing.
Yeah. Well, because those got me on one now, but those forbidden notes, that's what creates tension and release, isn't it? It's like if you put something that's not supposed to be there and resolve to something that is, that's great music, you know?
It's also partly to do with like the fact that equal temperament wasn't a thing. If you work out the scale of notes just from frequencies, the scale of notes is technically wrong. There, it's off a little bit once you get back up to the octave. So for ages, things like thirds and sixths and things like that were sort of banned because they were derived from further up the scale, or not banned so much as you had to be very careful how you use them. And it wasn't until mass production of instruments and equal temperament was worked out that you could suddenly play loads of pieces of music in different keys and sort of transition easily between them.
Oh, that's so cool. I love the history of musical instruments like that. Howard Goodall's a good guy to watch for that kind of history of music type stuff, isn't he? You showed me his stuff.
And that's exactly where I ripped that from.
You do it just as good as he does, though.
I'm not sure the viewing public would agree.
I mean, complete side note, but I need to go back and watch all those Howard Goodall documentaries again now because they're so good, particularly the Beatles one.
Yes. I mean, I just enjoy watching Howard Goodall. There's a great... he did the music for Red Dwarf, and there's a great feature on one of the DVDs where he sort of explains his choices for the music and says, okay, I'm specifically not writing sitcom music here, like, because the whole point is to lean into the genre of the show. I think he did Blackadder as well.
Yeah.
Which, again, it sort of plays true to that. That isn't sitcom music. That's music to sort of heighten the era. The comedy comes from the performers. Mm. Same with Red Dwarf. Like, the music isn't comedy music. It's very much... you could put that over most sci-fi shows and it would sound really cool. It's just the fact that it's funny comes from the stupid people on the spaceship that we're following.
Yeah. I mean, maybe that's what makes his shows a bit more timeless, is that the music is of the era. Even with Blackadder 4, you've got that military music.
Exactly, yeah. It creates a more... it helps to create a more distinct identity. And it's something that most people don't consciously realize, but, like, it must register somewhere that, like, this show, it doesn't sound like other shows of this nature.
Yeah, exactly. It's one of those visceral things where you just go, it just hits a little differently, doesn't it?
Mm. Helps that they're very much like themed comedies as well, as opposed to just being like the standard sitcom setup of like a group of mates or like a family or something. Where it's like, no, this one's set in history. This one's set in space.
Yeah, makes them stand out, love it, by a country mile, definitely.
So your song, Roger.
I'd rather talk about Howard Goodall than my music. The only final thing I have on this one in my little notes here is in the chorus I go, well, the world goes round and round and I just stand hiding like a bird with my head in the sand. Nice, easy, simple rhyme structure. Now, I had to question myself because I was like, which bird puts their head in the sand? An ostrich, right? Google. Yes, it's an ostrich. So why don't I have hiding like an ostrich with my head in the sand? And the answer is pretty much because bird just scans a little smoother. Say again?
It wouldn't fit.
I mean, you could cram it, but it wouldn't be very pretty.
I'm like an ostrich with my head in the sand. It you could like put it in once just to confuse people.
yeah, exactly. It's one of those things where it's like meaning, proper meaning versus how good it sounds. Like hiding like an ostrich with my head in the sand is more like factually good than with a bird in the head. It's like, not all birds put their head in the sand, you know?
Oh, there's a great story of, you know, the... oh, what song is it? It's like, there are 500 bicycles in da-da, or something like that. It's...
another one. I don't know the name of the song, though.
Editing Declan, if you work out what it is, put it on screen now. And I'm assuming he's forgotten to do that. So, there was... it's based around, like, a load of sort of facts. But, there was one really literal music review said, okay, these aren't facts. This isn't a fact. This isn't a fact. These are what the actual facts should be for all of them. And it was just this unscannable thing. I think there's a clip somewhere of like, they got the artist in to do like a joke version of the cover. It's like she rounded like the number of how many miles to the sun we are. And in the recording, so we are 3.9967838 miles from the sun. That's an estimate. We're very good thereabouts.
We are 12 billion light years from the edge. That's a guess. No one can ever say it's true, but I know that I will always be with you. 13.7 billion light years from the edge of the observable universe. That's a good estimate with well-defined error bars. And with the available information,
I predict that I will always be with you.
Oh, that's funny. I like that. Yeah, I mean, you can't have even poetry be completely factual all the time. If you want facts, go to a fact school.
Go to a fact school. Read a book, preferably not a fiction one.
Yeah. Oh, man. Well, yeah, so that's my song. And
are you really like it? What are you going to do with it?
Probably record it. The question is, to add drums or not? Because this past weekend, I added drums and they didn't fit. But maybe that's not because I'm not a great drummer. Maybe I just need to have, you know, a good drummer.
I think there should definitely be drums on this. I also think it should be like very like... like that very driving kind of...
You like an 8-beat that just doesn't let up.
Yeah. And then like maybe like going to like a 4-beat to allow more space for the dancey bass on the chorus. So like so 4 on the chorus and then 8 on the verse.
The thing I love about your ideas is like the moment I hear you say it, I'm like, yep, that is just happening. That's just a great idea. And that's just the way the song's gonna be now. That's great.
I have the power to define these songs in your head.
Yeah. I love it. See, that's why it wasn't working, is because I was just doing an 8-beat. Well, not throughout the entire thing, that'd be really boring, but just, you know, keeping it on the 8s rather than 4s. Anyway, we're getting long with this section, so be back in a sec. Okay, right, time for our regular section, which we've been doing for a couple of seasons now. It's called What Have You Been Listening To, Ian?
Yes, what have you been listening to, Ian?
Well, Ian's absence speaks volumes. So instead I'm going to ask you, Declan, what have you been listening to this past week? And imagine just a couple of little things. What are you listening to?
Just a few. This will have to be a bit of a speed run. Heritage Orchestra, The Breaks, which is kind of like a recording of like loads of famous hip-hop bits. That's fun. Koala... Better With You. BBC Radio 1's Live Lounge, 2016.
Gotta love a live lounge.
Madonna, Confessions on a Dance Floor. Or is it of a dance floor? No, it's on a dance floor.
Confessions on a dance floor. I'm a dance floor. I've done so many horrible things.
Grover Washington Jr., Wine Lights. This is the album that's got just the two of us.
Oh, nice.
BBC Radio 1's Live Lounge 2015. I found a lot of these cheap.
They're always good.
Lionel Richie, Back to Front. I thought this was an album. It's the greatest hits. But it does have a few of the Commodore singles that are difficult to find now, like Easy, and it has stuff that I didn't have before, like Three Times a Lady.
Winner.
Django Django, Off Planet Parts 1 to 4. Enjoyed.
Huh.
Gonna take some tidying up later. John Batiste, World Music Radio.
He's good. I like him. Heard some stuff from him.
Yeah, he's good. He's a good lad. He's a good lad. It's our John. Joan Armour Trading, Greatest Hits, but specifically the only Greatest Hits where the tracks from How Cruel are put on here, which is the only way you can get the tracks from How Cruel on CD.
Oh, okay.
The Bloodhound Gang, Hooray for Boobies. There is one good track on here.
Ah, an album like that. They suck.
It was cheap. BBC Radio 1's Live Lounge 2013.
I'm noticing a pattern.
We're still only about halfway through. We're going to have to cut this down in editing so much. Halsey, If I Can't Have Love, I Want Power. This is great. This is actually produced by Trent Reznor.
Oh yeah, I saw a making of video of it on YouTube. Very good.
It's very good. Troye Sivan, Something to Give Each Other.
Enjoy. I like the album cover.
It's a very good album cover. Bowling for Soup, A Hangover You Don't Deserve. Again, another one of those ones. It feels weirdly dated. It's very much like it's got this very weird streak running through it. But it was cheap, and it's got the song 1985 on it.
Great song. And that's considered classic rock now. They play that on oldies radio.
Yep, because we're old. Nerd in Search Of. Very much enjoyed.
Yeah, that's a good album. I've heard that one.
BBC Radio 1's Live Lounge 2012. Motown Classics, because I was missing a few of the key tracks. Most of the good stuff is on here. There are two weird omissions, though. There's no My Girl, and there's Ain't No Valley High Enough. Ain't No Mountain High Enough, sorry. Ain't No Valley High Enough?
That's weird. That's like the Motown song. No, sort of.
But everything else is on there. So it's like, cool, I've got all those now.
Yeah.
BBC Radio 1's Lifeline, Volume 5. Boy Genius, the record. I didn't like this initially, or like I wasn't super keen on it. But then I re-listened to it, and Past Declan is an idiot. And you can tell him I said that.
Yeah, nothing wrong with a bit of the Boy Geniuses.
Frankie Goes to Hollywood, Welcome to the Pleasure Dome.
Thank you.
Joseph, Permanent Damage.
Huh.
Prince and the New Power Generation, Diamonds and Pearls.
Underrated record.
This one's got Cream on it. I need to clean it off. No, I'm sorry.
I think that's one of the ones that Prince raps on, which is,
it is
always a nice, you know, always nice to hear.
It's something. BBC Rowan's Radio Live Lounge Volume 4. There are no more, I swear.
But people who don't know what they are, by the way, like overseas or something, like famous artists come into the BBC radio studios and they usually do, is it one of their own songs and then they cover somebody else's song in their style?
Yes, and it's normally like a song that's current in the charts at that moment. There are a lot of very standard, like acoustic, yes, we'll do the slow version, we'll get the acoustic guitars out, we'll have a soulful piano bit. But you get some really weird ones and some really fun ones. Like one of my favourite ones sort of going through this pile was Dizzy Rascal doing Bonkers with like a slide guitar and a cajon, or like an electric slide guitar. And it fits really well.
Yeah. Nice.
Janelle Monáe, The Arch Android. Enjoyed.
Gotta love her. I really like Janelle Monáe. Great artist.
I need to get The Age of Pleasure. That's a good record. The Weeknd, House of Balloons.
Been a while since I've seen a copy of that.
Yes. Well, now you have.
Hooray!
Kylie Minogue, Tension, which includes the song Padam, Padam. I hear it and I know. And then Missy Elliott, Respect Me.
Best for last, eh?
Well, actually, kind of, yes, because I also picked up a vinyl. Lottery Winners, Anxiety Replacement Therapy, which is an album I really liked last year. And it is staticky as all hell, so it's difficult to get out of there, but it's see-through.
Oh, that's really... Oh, you have to send me a track of theirs. I've never heard of them before.
Oh, I absolutely shall. I recommend this album quite highly.
Oh, okay.
So that's that.
Very nice. Very nice. That's some haul.
Yes, that was most of my weekend. Was just listening to music. So now that we've stretched this episode out for about 2 hours, what about yourself? What have you been listening to? If you don't beat my total number of records, there will be some minor penalty, I'm sure.
Minor penalty. Well, for me, it's just been Jimi Hendrix.
It's a solid choice. Which one?
Axis Boulder's Love.
Ooh.
Mostly. I've listened to Electric Ladyland and Are You Experienced too, but I've gone back to, because you know me, I'll just repeat, listen to something endlessly. Axis Boulder's Love, just on repeat. That's my favorite of those records he made.
Spanish Castle Magic is a contender for one of my favorite Hendrix songs. It's such a cool riff.
Same. Yeah, I think there's so much good stuff on those records. And then I watched a documentary on him as well. Just got really into him over the past week. And I like those loads of stuff. I like Little Wing a lot. You and I used to jam on the chords to Little Wing back when I was at my dad's house. And that was fun. But
that
I
was fun, and I can't remember what they are anymore.
Oh no, they're kind of complicated. But there's a lovely bit because it's in E minor. It goes down from B minor, B flat minor, A minor, and you could do loads of cool guitar solo stuff on that. All that stuff.
You were always better at that than I was.
I don't think so. But I mean, as I've only got the one album, I'll speak on Jimi Hendrix a little bit. I read an interview with Todd Rundgren where he said that he loves Jimi Hendrix and he's got a real, like, you know, real, he's a real fan. But he prefers the earlier stuff before he got more experimental in the studio. He said that was better music. But I think I disagree with Todd. I like the early stuff, like Wind Cries Mary and all that kind of stuff. But I think that's why I like Axis so much, is because it was still very band-based. And Mitch Mitchell is just I love his drumming so much. I think they were such a good duo. But it was still very band-based, but they started to throw in, you know, reverse stuff and effects and vary speed and all that. So I don't know. What do you think of the record, Axis, Baldur's Love?
I quite enjoy it. I've got a vinyl copy of it that sounds more alive than I've heard any vinyl sound. Like, it's very sort of, it feels, it's one of the few records I own where it actually legitimately feels like the vinyl recording is a bit better than the CD version. I think I'm with you in that I tend to prefer Hendrix as a song crafter more than I do an experimenter. But then I also like when that does inform the songs a little bit. Like, my favorite Hendrix song is probably Cross Down Traffic.
Yeah.
And I love the bit like where it goes across the stereo field in the beginning, like do 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 do, and then to come in with that great riff, which I think is doubled with kazoo.
I think it is.
Which yeah, it's really cool. And then all the jazz chords in there, but like you wouldn't necessarily know it just listening to it.
Yeah, no, totally. He was really I don't know, people I think on the surface look at him and go rock and roll guitarist playing with his teeth, but there were so many influences going on. I mean, even if you look at Mitch Mitchell, like there's so much going on in his drum style that was informed by Coltrane and all these different people. And I think from what I saw on this documentary, Mitch Mitchell showed Jimmy a lot of Coltrane and a lot of like jazz influence stuff. So I think that's probably where those jazz chords and so much going on in there. I can only imagine what Hendrix would have done had he lived into the 70s and through the prog rock era.
I think there is a story, and you're going to have to forgive me because I can't remember which artist specifically it is. I think it's Miles Davis. But I think there was a story of Jimi Hendrix wanting to do more jazz stuff. So he was planning to do like a duet album with, again, I think it's Miles Davis. Correct me if I'm wrong. But yeah, it would be fascinating to sort of hear what those two would have done, because this was a little bit before Bitches Brew.
Ah, yeah, that would have gone in some really strange directions.
Yeah, we're living in the wrong timeline.
I know, but yeah, I mean, I agree with you. I'm more of a fan of Jimmy as a songwriter, which I don't feel like he gets enough credit for. Kind of like the Freddie Mercury thing, where like he's just a fantastic songwriter. But people look at him as, you know, rightly so, as a guitar icon and stuff. But I like, my favorite stuff is where the songwriting meets the experimentation and somewhere in the middle. And yeah, I don't know, he's great.
Jimi Hendrix is good. That's our controversial opinion for the day.
Yes. Okay, so that is our regular section. What have you been listening to, Ian? Ian is absent. So
again, we're going to have words with him.
Oh, I mean, you know, can't carry on like this.
No, it's letting everyone down.
Knock my microphone.
So if you'd like to see more of Ian, please write to, for goodness sake, Ian, get it together at weeklysongpodcast@gmail.com.
Speaking of emails, we have one such email. This email is from Tim from Rough Guess Music. And Tim writes with the subject line, great podcast. Thank you, Tim. He writes, hi, Declan and Roger. I've been enjoying your weekly song podcast over the past few years, and it's great to now watch your show on YouTube. It's amazing that you've been at this for 18 seasons. As a hobbyist songwriter and home recording enthusiast, I really appreciate the time you spend on analysis and deconstruction of your weekly compositions. I always end up with a few interesting tips or avenues of exploration by episode end, and your friendly rapport and humor keeps things fun and engaging. Oh, thank you. Roger's recent foray into songwriting from a villain's perspective with the fiendishly delightful Better the Devil You Know had me thinking of my recent song, Forever Gone, which is also narrated by a villain. My song is about an outlaw whose evil past finally catches up to him. It's one of a series of cowboy songs that I wrote after acquiring an old 1930s Martin 017. Quit bragging. A terrific fingerstyle guitar for this type of music. It's really interesting how a fresh, he says to me, instrument can inspire new songs. This genre of song has also prompted me to break out my harmonica after a 30-year hiatus. Oh, sweet. Anyway, enough rambling. I've attached an MP3 of Forever Gone if you're interested in listening to it. I post much of my original music on my YouTube channel, Rough Guess Music. Great thanks to both of you for supporting your songwriting process. I mean, sorry, for sharing your songwriting process and for providing such a terrific resource for aspiring songwriters. All the best, Tim from Rough Guess Music. And as he said, he's attached the song Forever Gone, which we could listen to now, and it sounds a little bit like this.
My life's a tragic tale of murder and betrayal, and penance paid for living oh so wrong. Ride the devil's trail and hear the nightingale calling out his mournful midnight song. I'm forever gone, forever gone, forever gone. My soul's forever gone, forever forced to ride. Demons at my side, my soul is forever gone. Trail that I abhor. Well, the devil signed my deed. I'm never to be freed. Hungry, bleary-eyed, and saddle-sore. Forevermore. 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 I will ride forevermore. Forever on this trail, with Satan at my tail, I will ride forevermore.
Fantastic. That was Forever Gone. By Tim from Rough Guest Music. Again, you can find his stuff on YouTube. We've just had like a slew of like the best guest music this season. It's been great.
It's great. We don't have to do anything. We just get to listen to some fantastic music. This is very yee-haw. I like this.
Yeah. In like chordally, lyrically, obviously. I love the sort of villain theme, but also production-wise, like you got guitar sounds so good. You can tell it's like a vintage guitar, and that lovely harmonica playing as well. Really cool.
And there's really nice slide or electric bits in there as well. Like, that sounds like there's not much more in the mix than those elements, but that's all you really need. It creates this wonderful sort of atmosphere, which again, seeing as a perspective of the song, is like this outlaw. It sort of feeds in really well.
Absolutely, yeah. I'd be curious, because Tim says he does home recording, if that's him playing everything. I kind of get the feeling it is, but I mean, whoever was on the slide, or maybe it was like a Gretsch thing, because it kind of like dipped the whammy bar or something like that. Whatever it was, very, very tasteful playing. Yeah, thank you so much, Tim, for sending it in. Really, really cool to hear that.
One out of one. Yeehaw.
Yeehaw!
That's it for this episode of the Weekly Song Podcast. Thank you very much for listening. If you have a song of your own that you'd like to send in, if you've got any thoughts on whatever we've presented or talked about, if you just want to shame Ian for not turning up week after week after week, then why not write to us at weeklysongpodcast@gmail.com? You can also find us on Instagram. There's a YouTube version to this podcast now. You might be watching it. Hello if you are. You can follow us on all of the various places where you find podcasts, like SoundCloud and iTunes and all of the other places like that. It's been a while since I've done one of these outros, and I feel like I'm slightly rambling, but we'll keep this take in. It's all good. It's just a nice, gentle, doesn't know when to stop energy. So we'll round ourselves gently towards a conclusion. Although I will first mention that Roger and I do have a band called Schnookums, S-C-H-N-O-O-K-U-M-S. Our first album, called Attaboy, is currently out now, and you can buy, stream, do whatever you'd like with that music. Not anything you'd like with that music. There are some strict rules about like selling music, and like copyright is a thing, but you have a listen to it. Why don't you?
Yeah, it's that's probably the best option to do with our album. I mean, there are other options, but that's my favorite one.
Indeed, I would concur. And talking of music, Roger, where can people find your music out here on the interweb?
Yeah, and just to add to what you said about the Schnookums, our collaborative project, for the album you just mentioned, Attaboy, we did an episode, a few episodes, basically, you scroll up your podcast feed. We did a Schnookum Spectacular, we called it, and it's just like a fun conversation, discussion, dissection of the album, how we made it, and definitely worth a listen, if you like that kind of thing. As for where you can find my music, you can find it at rogerheathers.bandcamp.com. My latest album is called Racing Alone, and I'm still pushing it, you know? There's a thing, when you put out an album, I'm only going to promote this 49 more times, okay? So 48 now, okay? So I also am on Instagram, and my music's everywhere else on the streaming platforms. And I write weekly blogs about demoing, which you can find at rogerheathers.substack.com. And that's me. Declan, where can people find you and your music?
You can find me in far fewer places. I have an album and a couple of EPs out. You can find them on all the streaming services and all the places where you normally find music like that, provided I've remembered to tick all the little buttons before I pressed publish. You can also find me on Instagram, I believe. Like, if you follow the Weekly Song Podcast, I believe I'm in the description there somewhere. And that's about it. I don't have quite as much going on as Roger does.
I mean, I will say, Declan's music is well worth taking a listen to if you haven't heard it before, if you're new to the show. Particularly, my favorite of Declan's is Apathy Will Get You Nowhere, which is his full-length record. Well worth a listen. And, yeah.
Yes, and I'll just send you that 20 quid now.
Ah, okay, thanks. Come through here. Perfect, thank you. Same again next week.
This is an expensive show for me.
Yeah, so next week, what is next week? Week 5 of writing.
We can count. We're musicians. We only know how to count to 4. After that, it gets a bit dicey.
Oh, it's flying by, though. It really is.
Indeed. I can't believe it's the middle of the season already.
Crazy. But yeah, thanks all so much very much for listening. I can't speak at the end of the episodes. Thank you all so very much for listening. No, seriously, appreciate everyone tuning in and supporting the YouTube version of the podcast. And yeah, we're looking forward to catching you on the next one here on the Weekly Song Podcast.
In a week, because it's in our name. All that remains is for us to give you a hearty ta-ra. Ta-ra.
Ta-ra.